My name is Dan Marenda. We're at Drexel University in Philadelphia. In my laboratory, we study how synapses are formed, how the nervous system develops and connects with each other. We study three different diseases in my lab. We study Alzheimer's disease, which is a neurodegenerative disease that mostly affects elderly people. And then we study two neurodevelopmental disorders. One is called CHARGE syndrome, which is a very rare disease, but it affects about 1 in 10,000 live births. And another one is called Pitt-Hopkins, which is even rarer. And so we take fruit flies, tiny little fruit flies that buzz around in your kitchen, and we take human genes and we put them inside of the fruit fly, and then we turn those genes on in the fruit fly, and we give the fruit flies the disease. The human disease.
And you see all these little dots. Mm-hmm. Those are the same little protein aggregates that happen in human brains.
So we can then study the human disease in this tiny little animal and better understand it in humans. I came from a small town in central Illinois called Spring Valley, Illinois. Population of about 5,000 people. And so when I grew up, there weren't any scientists around me. I went to college in Chicago, and that's where I first really got exposed to working in a research laboratory and performing research. My great-grandmother was an amazing person, and she was always outside. She knew everything there was to know about the animals and the plants in the area that we lived. She kept a garden, and I would go out there and essentially work in the garden with her and ask her all these questions about nature. And so I really got interested in science through my interest in nature because of my great-grandmother. I think if there was a human connection that made me become interested in the kinds of diseases I study, then that person would be this child that I helped diagnose when I was a technician working in an MD-PhD's lab. It would be this child who I never met, but we purified his DNA and we found a mutation that he had that was related to a disease called Batten's disease. And my thought that if we could simply identify the disease, then we would be able to fix the child or help the child in some way. And then my realization that identifying the disease was just a step in a potential long journey to try and create a therapy. And in that journey, we as a field of medicine, we were just here at the very beginning. We could identify the disease, but there was nothing we could do. That so profoundly affected me that I think that's when I really made the decision to go into science, specifically to research neurodevelopmental disorders in kids. So what I typically do in the laboratory is I oversee the research of my graduate students, my undergraduate students, and my postdocs who work in the laboratory, intellectually contributing to the design of experiments, interpretation of results, troubleshooting experiments when they don't go well. I think lab life is very vibrant. You're never doing the same thing all the time. I think in a laboratory you're asking you ask a question that doesn't have an answer, right? And so your ultimate goal is to try and design experiments which will help answer that question, yes or no.
So she didn't like change her major or anything because she couldn't get over.
Academically, our hope is that we contribute to the greater understanding of, in our case, neurobiology and developmental neurobiology. We can apply what we learn so that we can develop therapy for some of the diseases that are directly associated with the science that we do. So if our research turns out to be amazing and we are able to, say, identify a drug that can be used for therapy for Alzheimer's disease patients, that would be wonderful. That would be amazing. The lifestyle of a researcher is never really boring. So you're always thinking about the big picture, and sometimes you're seeing things literally for the first time, and to me that's very powerful.